Everybody, it's good to have you all. And I guess you can look at the bulletin, the cover of the bulletin, it says this is Christmas in July, okay? Because we need to do Christmas in July. And I was looking look at the cover, just look at the cover of the bulletin, okay? And then in a minute, you're going to pass the piece, and so there's someone here that kind of resembles that a little bit. I'm not going to say who it is, but there is somebody that resembles that a little bit, okay? All right. So announcements, if you look on the inside, we want to say welcome to Murphy James Glauman. That is Amy Glauman was here she sings in the choir last Sunday, and she was in the choir, and then she had that baby on July the 4th. So there he is. And of course, Ryan teaches over at Tarleton. He teaches statistics, and so... You see the quote there from him. It's a future statistician. He'd probably wind up being a football player or something like that. Got kids. This Sunday breakfast is mark a calendar for that, because it's really a treat. It's really an unhealthy treat, but it's still a treat. And so you want to go and support the Methodist family. And then you'll see also a litany. We won't do it in this service unless she comes. But this is an order of recognition for a global young people's convocation, which is going to be in South Africa, which Courtney McGuire is going to, she's be leaving, I guess, Saturday, this coming Saturday, to go to Johannesburg. So if you see her, congratulate her. Okay? And then next Sunday, this Thursday, we have eight ladies from the church that are going up on the Emmaus Walk. And this Emmaus Walk is at a new place, fairly new for us in the conference. It's at the Lone Star Camp, and that's up on Lake Neon. And so that's where we're going to be for that. So be in prayer for those eight ladies. They'll come back, and they'll be all refreshed and excited. And they'll be busy with you. All right, any other announcements? Oh, and you see that Travis is not here because Travis is in China with some of the choir people into China, and they asked Travis to go as a chaperone. And he's the youngest one of all of them, and he's the chaperone. I don't understand that. That's right. So anyway, so Corey Moses, he's the director of the our Tarleton Wesley, and so he is substituting for Travis today. So we pass the peace, Corey, if you just go out there and shake a few hands, it'll get to meet you for another. Okay, any other announcements? Okay, would you stand? Let's pray. Oh God, for this day we give you thanks. This is the Lord's day. And this is the day that we have not lived, but we are living into this day. And so we give you praise. And we ask that you send people our way, that you send thoughts our way, and how we may better serve you in your world in which we are your servants. Bless us as we worship, because this charges us up for the week. So bless us as we worship in Jesus' name. Amen. if you put your guitar down if you can and just come out and just shake some people's hands so they get to know you, and then you pass the peace of Christ, okay? So do that, please.
Upon your shoulders.
This is our prayer today, so let's bow and pray. God of grace and love, we pray as the psalmist when they say, incline your ear, Lord, and hear our prayers. We ask you to hear us this day. Hear that we are thankful for this time to pause and listen to your voice. We're thankful for this place where we can connect to your presence. Lord, we've heard good news today about the young boys in the cave in Thailand. Many of them are now safely out of the cave, and we pray for a safe passage of the others. We've heard good news about many of our choir people have gone to China, and we pray for their safety. We've heard good news about one of our youth, Courtney McGuire, going to South Africa. So we pray that you give her a safe passage there back. And we hear other news. Fires in the west and floods in the east and drought here at home. We pray as the psalmist would pray. And we pray, Lord, hear our prayers and deliver us. We come to you today seeking forgiveness for all the times that we failed to live up to the people that you've called us to be, your people in the world. Forgive us for all the times we failed ourselves. Mend the broken places, Lord, we ask that. And fill the empty spaces, because we need you with us and in us. Today we offer you ourselves, our happiness, our sadness, our mourning, our concerns, our anger, our disappointment, our questions, and our dreams. And now, Lord, through our singing, through the words that we see on the screens, through the silence, through our listening and our service, through our personal and our corporate prayers, we offer you our worship. We do that in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray his prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We ask the ushers now to come for the giving and the receiving of this day's tithes and offerings. Amen. devil was angry, and he asked, it wasn't hot enough for him. It's not hot enough down here for you. And the man replied, "Why? It reminds me of a July day in Galveston, where it's 98 degrees and 98% humidity. Yeah, that's about what that is." So the devil turned up the heat. Later that day, it seemed that the man from Texas was still enjoying himself. So the devil asked, "Is it still not hot enough down here for you?" And the man replied, "Well, it seems like a 4th of July picnic at Willie Nelson's. That's what it seemed like." And so Satan decided to use reverse psychology and to turn down the temperature. And so that's what happened in hell. And when the devil found the Texan, he was singing and shouting. And the devil said, "Why are you still so happy?" And the man replied, "Well, when I look at all these obstacles in here, I reckon the Dallas Cowboys just won the Super Bowl."
Finally.
Get that metaphor? That's how that works. Well, it's not really a true story, but you see how it probably could be something. Well, welcome to the dog days of summer. My goodness. How many 100-degree days have we had? Anybody keep a record of that?
Two.
I guess nobody is. I thought it was 10 or something like that. I don't know. But I don't know. But we've got a little break, and so I'm thankful for that. I think it's fitting that we celebrate Christmas in July. At least people think it's cooler. Okay? I mean, you just think cooler when you see a Christmas tree, don't you? I mean, don't you? Actually, Christmas in July was an ideal picked up by business, okay? Because, and now it's marketed for consumers. So you'll see a lot of those Christmas in July sales. See a lot of that? That's kind of a popular thing now. For a few churches, it's a major celebration. I was reading about this on the internet. Some churches, this is a big deal for them. They have gifts, they exchange, everybody in the church exchange gifts, and they do service projects in the community as Christmas projects. Well, let me offer you three reasons to celebrate Christmas in July. Number one, there's never been any credible evidence as to when Jesus was born. We don't know that. I mean, it could have been in July. It could have been in December. So we just, tradition says, celebrate on the 25th of December, and that's what we do. And number two, for you Swedes, the Scandinavian word for Yule is Jule, okay? Which happens to be pretty close to the word July, right? If it's Scandinavian. And the last reason is validated. I'll explain that later. Okay, some of you already saw it because you already know what I'm going to say. So here we have a lack of historical date, we have a Scandinavian word association, and we have validated. And so now a Christmas text. There's probably several of them, a lot of them. But this is for July. And this is from the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. This is from the Message translation. So it's a great translation of John 3:16. This is how much God loved the world. God gave Jesus, his one and only Son, and this is why. So that no one need be destroyed. By believing in Jesus, anyone can have a whole and lasting life. God didn't go to all the trouble of sending his Son merely to point an accusing finger, telling the world how bad it was. Jesus came to help, to put the world right again. Anyone who trusts in him is acquitted. That's a good word. That's a good motto. Anyone that trusts in Jesus, John says, is acquitted. Anyone who refuses to trust him has long since been under the death sentence without even knowing it. Don't even know it. And why? Because that person's failure to believe in the one-of-a-kind Son of God when introduced to him. Most of the world would agree, some reluctantly, that Christmas is about this Son of God that John speaks of. He was formerly known as Jesus and formerly known as an infant. But he grew up and became the Messiah, the King of the earth, an invisible kingdom. A lot of people are stuck. Here's the point. A lot of people are stuck in their ideal of Jesus. To them, he's still a baby. And And that's where the Talladega reference comes in. Remember the movie Talladega Nights? Okay, some of you have seen it and some of you haven't. Okay? My wife has not seen it. So when I told her about this reference, she just looked at me like, I don't get it. But if you watched it, then you get it. If you did, you cannot forget the fictional character Ricky Bobby. Right? Listen to his infamous prayer. They were all sitting around a supper table, and here's what he prayed. Dear tiny Jesus, with your golden fleece diapers, with your tiny little fat ball robed up fist. Ricky's interrupted by his friend, reminding him that Jesus grew up and grew a beard. And Ricky continued his prayer. Look, I like the baby version the best. And he went on. And Ricky Bobby is not alone. The contemporary inclination is for us to picture Jesus the way we want to picture Jesus. We all do it. Every one of us do it. All of us make Jesus or God into our image. An image that we can picture. This is what God looks like. An image we can understand. An image we can relate to, an image that we can manipulate. Jesus was everything we could possibly imagine and then some. So here's the problem. Our image of Jesus / God is always faulty. It's always faulty. And here's the reason. Because it's ours. Your image and my image is faulty. Our image of Jesus is not evolved. Our image of Jesus is usually created with the intent to manipulate or coerce other people by our beliefs. Let's bring it then into present company. How do you see Jesus right now? Is your friend? A lot of people do. As a celebrity? A lot of people do. As a superstar? As your ticket to heaven, your get out of hell free card, a lot of people do. Trust me, they do. As your drinking buddy, a lot of folks do. As your ideal husband, a lot of women do. I'm afraid that most of us see Jesus as a handsome, clean-cut, white American male. Don't we? I mean, we do. I grew a full beard when I went to college in Missouri. Look at Grant. That's what I grew a beard just like that.
And it
was, I had hair on top too. And it was black, and it was that thick. I was really proud of it. I came home. I guess, I don't know if it was at Christmas time or maybe it was even spring break or something. And so I drove back home, and I went to see my grandmother. And when I went to her house, as soon as I walked in, she wanted to shoot me. She said, men don't wear beards. But I said piously, what about Jesus? And what about the Levitical command to wear a beard? You're supposed to wear a beard if you're a Jewish male. And what about the prophet Isaiah, when he said that when Jesus was crucified, that they would pluck his beard out? What about all that? And she said, and I quote, I don't care what you say the Bible says. Men shouldn't have facial hair, period. End of discussion. I didn't say anything else because I thought, well, I've invested here, haven't I? I didn't have the heart to tell her that she was stuck in a previous generation. Grandma, you're stuck. You're stuck. You need to move a little bit. What's going to happen? It never did happen. Some people see Jesus as their personal physician who will make sure that they and their loved ones never get cancer. I've met some people like that. Evangelicals see Jesus as a Republican. That's amazing, isn't it? Democrats see Jesus as a liberal. And this is their quote. He did ride a donkey after all. Right? Get that reference? The fact is, we should be better. We should be better than Ricky Bobby in seeing Jesus. We need help. And we need to know where we are in making Jesus. as we go along, because that's what we do. We need to stop and examine our motives and be aware of our desire to want control. This is why we ought to resist the simple answers. I mean, I've heard so many simple answers and questionable Jesus images that have been shaped into our biases. What images of Jesus limit your pursuit of Christian growth? What pictures do you and I need to jettison for the good of the world that Jesus died for? Because we need to get rid of that thinking. It's hard to waste it. So why celebrate Christmas in July? I think so we can think about these things, and you and I are not right in our thinking. Okay? Gives us an opportunity to think about it. How do you see Jesus right now? A reformer? A mystic? A political revolutionary? A prophet? A healer? A sage? A theologian? A magician? A miracle worker? That's just a sample of how the world sees Jesus. My hunch is this, and I think this is true. If we wait until December, it's too late. We will be caught up in an avalanche of sentimentality and pseudo-responsibility and romanticism about Christmas. Don't we all do, don't we? And anything said from the pulpit, we just can't hear it. It's like, what are you saying? In doing so, we cannot see what Jesus is calling us to do or to be his disciples. So what should we do? Well, surrender our thoughts and our biases to Jesus. Just surrender them to him. We might not be too sure of our thoughts, but I guarantee you, we know our prejudices, don't we? And we know our preferences. We know what those are. Are we willing to surrender those to Jesus? And read for ourselves in the Gospels. I mean, I hear so many people say, well, the Bible says, and I just want to say, where? Because they know they can't reference that. Where does the Bible say that? Whatever their bias is, where does the Bible say that? Really? Because I want to see it. We should give our lives to him as our Savior, because we cannot save ourselves. Listen again to St. John's words. This is how much Jesus, or God, this is how much God loved the world. That God gave Jesus his one and only Son. And this is why he did it. So that we do not have to be ruined by the sins that so easily beset us. By trusting in Jesus, anyone can have a whole and lasting life. God did not send Jesus so that he could point a finger at us, telling us how bad we were. Rather, Jesus came to help, to reconcile us, to put the world right again. Anyone, then, who trusts in Jesus is acquitted. Anyone who refuses to trust him has a death sentence, and they don't even know why. But it's because they failed to believe in the one-of-a-kind Son of God when introduced to him. We all have a choice. We all have a choice. Merry Christmas. Amen. Let's pray. Oh God, as your people, one thing that we lack a lot of times is to think. Just think about something. Whatever it is we hear in the news. Because sometimes we just get upset and we get active and we cannot hear another side of anything that we hear. So Lord, help us to sit. Help us to think. And if it's something about Scripture, help us to look, to read your text, to see what Jesus is really like, and then to shape our lives like his. Bless us, we're your people, and thank you for your celebration that you give us. These things we ask in Christ's name. Amen. Would you stand? Have a song. temptation and whatever your needs are, I'm here to pray with you. So it's got to be Travis's fault. Right, let me get out.
You said it, not me.